in to the 49ers Rush podcast, and here is your host, John Chapman.
All right, welcome to another episode of the 49ers Rush podcast with me, your host, John Chapman. Hopefully, this intro music will last a little bit longer. The copyright claims are out the window, man. They are just coming through. So I want to make sure created some original stuff, and hopefully that will be the end of that. But today we are going to continue. I'm really excited. We are going to be putting a nice bow tie on our NFL draft coverage. We are going to be covering the last three draft picks for the 49ers today in Kaden Smith, Justin Skule, and Tim Harris. So we're going to break down each one of their background, stats, kind of measurements, what they did at the combine or not the combine for a few of these guys, where they fit, scheme fit, and all those things. And this is the last episode. If you have not already tried to enter in for the autographed Joe Montana jersey, this will be the last episode to do that. On the next episode next week, we will be announcing the winner. So we will talk a little bit more about that about halfway through this podcast. So without further ado, let's just jump straight into this. One of the picks I was most excited about out of this entire draft class was one of our sixth-round pick, Kaden Smith, tight end out of Stanford. We took him, pick number three in the sixth round, number 176 overall, and he was the highest-ranked player on my big board at that time. Not the biggest fan of the draft as a whole. If you've been listening to the series, if you want to go back and look at the previous episode where I break down all the previous picks, those are available for you. Now, obviously, we got some major talent. However, Kaden Smith was one of the guys that actually fit a major need and I think is a scheme fit as well. I love this kid's game. I had a third round grade on him, and to get him in the sixth round, it's very obvious why he fell. He's very slow. He's actually quicker than fast, I think is what you'd want to say. 6'5", 255 pounds, and he ran a 4.92. At the combine, which that is not great, but we are not going to be using him as a tight end one. He is going to be that tight end two fit. He is going to be fighting with Garrett Celek right off the bat to try to win that number two spot. I doubt that we keep both of them. I really do think that Celek's time is over, but we will just kind of have to see what happens with that. So let's jump into his game and kind of what I saw with film and some of those stats. So he's a possession tight end with great hands. He is a guy that extends very, very well, natural pass-catching tight end. And what I mean by that is he doesn't let the ball get into his body too often. His hands are very similar to a good wide receiver. His body, a little similar to an offensive tackle. So he's that hybrid tight end that's going to be blocking more often than not and might only see, you know, 1 to 2 targets a game and go a couple games without even receiving any targets whatsoever. He did injure his foot and miss the final three games, but seems very healthy now. You know, he participated at the combine, pro days, all that kind of stuff. He seems fine. He is tight-hipped, but the interesting thing about how he plays on the field is for his three cone, he went nuts. He ran a 7.08 three cone, which is wide receiver good. But whenever you watch him on film, you don't see any of that. And just to put that into perspective, Deebo Samuel ran a 7.03, and Kaden Smith, you know, 255 pounds, ran a 7.08. So just to put that into perspective, Deebo Samuel's three cone wasn't great. It was average for wide receivers. But for Kaden Smith, this is absolutely incredible. Kyle Shanahan absolutely loves those good three cone measurements. And so that's one of the things that I think might have put it over the top. Now, despite his lack of speed, he led the tight end class with the most deep ball reception. So with passes that traveled over 20 yards in the air, he had 7 deep ball receptions this year and 27 slot receptions. So they moved him around despite the fact that he's a big guy. And it's pretty fun watching him run routes because he's not a type of guy that's going to get separation. You could tell he was coached to do this because he's so big and he's a thumper and he loves contact. He runs straight at, whether it's a nickel corner, linebacker, safety on him, he runs straight at them. So let's say they're giving him, you know, a 5-6 yards off the ball and they're making their read. He runs straight at them, basically bench presses them, and then makes a move. Like, he feasts off of contact on his passing routes. And so, you know, they ask Kyle Shanahan, like, man, what are you going to do with this guy? He's slow. He ran a 4.9. And Kyle Shanahan said, you know, lack of speed's not an issue. I'm not going to send him on speed routes. He's a tough player that isn't scared and gets open with his feet and his hands. And that's what I saw on film as well. So whenever Kyle said that, I was like shaking my head like, oh, hell yeah. Like, we noticed the same thing. So that's a good thing. Now, he had 105 targets and a 66% catch rate, which is pretty good for a tight end, especially one that wants to initiate contact and have contested catches. He's not a guy that catches the ball out in space. He's really never in space. He's the type of guy on third and three, you're going to throw a 4 to 5 yard hitch route with a tight end or with a linebacker or a safety draped all over his back. He's going to kind of do like the basketball move where he shields the defender behind him, boxes him out, and catches the ball for a first down. He's a chain mover wide receiver. He's not your big play guy. Now, he's not a punishing blocker by any means, but he does use his feet and his arms very, very well. So instead of like punishing, you know, if we look at Kittle, he wants to kill people. That's not what Kaden Smith does. Kaden Smith is a boring blocker, and what I mean by that is you're not going to get a highlight from either side. He's not driving them off the ball, and he's not whiffing on blocks either. He's a stalemate blocker that doesn't get a whole bunch of movement, but if you need to keep a guy in to chip, let's say an excellent edge rusher, and you want to help your tackle and just give him an extra, you know, step before, that's the guy. This is who you want in that role. So he's a guy that really fits a major need for us. Our tight end two last year was just abysmal blocking. It was awful. He does line up everywhere. You know, at Stanford, they put him in the slot. He was in the backfield some, kind of like a Kyle Juszczyk situation. He was on the line of scrimmage. He was wide out, split wide out sometimes. So he can do all of that, and you've seen him do that. He did have a bad combine, but again, this is a guy that is a better football player than he is an athlete. My player comparison for him was Daniel Fells, but better in every way besides speed. So one of those just kind of true three-down tight ends, if that's what you want to use them for, or you can create some mismatches in the run game by shifting focus and messing up the defensive alignment with that if you want to go big. And again, you know, the theme with our front office is anybody with versatility. If they can do more than one thing, we love them. And versatility is turning into a cuss word for me now because I'm just getting tired of hearing it, and I want to see guys do what their primary role is. Now, John Lynch did say, you know, he makes plays in big moments. He's a gamer. He does have a big catch radius. He's very, very long. Now, the thing is this, you know, Stanford has kind of turned into the 49ers farm system. And whenever you look at tight end, even more so. Stanford has had 6 tight ends drafted in the NFL draft over the past 7 years. He's going to be able to play a lot. So again, they even said he's going to be competing with Selleck for a roster spot. I really do think that he is going to win out. His ceiling is just higher, and Selleck's game has been descending. Now, some more positives just on Kaden Smith real quick. He has played in a pro scheme up front, and so it's not going to be too much of a jump for him, I don't believe, because it's very similar concepts that Stanford runs and what we do. Obviously, it's different, but if there's probably about 3 to 4 different offensive systems that are similar to the NFL, and Stanford's going to be right up top with there. He is a 2-time academic All-Pac-12. He's a poli-sci major, pretty smart kid. He played basketball and football in high school for one of the top programs in Texas. This is a Dallas kid. He's from Flower Mound, Texas, and they were absolutely elite basketball and football, and the fact that he was a starter on both of those teams should say a lot. He was the second ranked tight end coming out of high school. He was a 5-star recruit and chose. He went with Stanford over the Texas Longhorns. I remember watching his film back whenever he was coming out of high school. The kid's legit, so I do expect Kaden to make this roster for sure. Now, before we get into our next prospect, Justin Skule, I do want to give you more details on how to win this Joe Montana jersey. First off, just want to say thank you to our sponsors. Man, Game Day Sports and Memorabilia, they have treated us very, very well. And just, I love all the free stuff that we get to give away just because of them. So head over to Game Day Sports and Memorabilia if you don't win, and you can pick up Joe Montana, Jerry Rice, all this different type of memorabilia signed. Now, for free, if you want to win it for free, it's very, very simple. All you have to do is go to my Twitter at JL_Chapman. It is my pinned tweet. If you click on my profile, you're going to see it there. A lot of you guys have already done it. The traffic has been wonderful. Make sure you're following me on Twitter. Retweet that tweet that has all the details in it. And then all you have to do after that is just go to my YouTube page, which it has the link on there. It's under John Chapman. And just leave a comment on any video with your Twitter handle and follow that YouTube account. Once you do that, you are entered. You don't have to do anything else. And my son will be drawing the name later this week, and I will keep you posted on that. So again, head over to Twitter at JL_Chapman, retweet, follow, and then make sure you are subscribed to that YouTube channel and leave that comment. That's it. And somebody's going to be winning a several hundred dollar jersey autographed by Joe Montana. So really excited to give that out. It's such a cool thing that they let us do. Again, thanks to Game Day Sports and Memorabilia. All right, the second prospect that we're going to be talking about today is Justin Skule, which he's got the coolest spelling ever, S-K-U-L-E, and it's pronounced school, like kids go to school. We got him in the sixth round, 10th pick, so about seven picks after Kaden Smith. He's number 183 overall, offensive tackle out of Vanderbilt, and this is a big kid. 6'7", 317 pounds. So you want a guy that, you know, has got length and size. Man, we've got two of the biggest dudes out there in McGlinchey and Justin Skule. This guy, he is going to be the backup swing tackle. You know, they asked him, you know, what's the idea behind here? And Kyle Shanahan didn't mix any words, which I love how honest he is. And he said, you know, the game's not too big for him. He started 48 games in the SEC, 40 consecutive games, 48 total. And he's fighting for Sean Coleman for that swing spot. So this is the backup tackle and he can play both left and right. You know, he's a big kid. So he started 2 years at Vanderbilt at the left tackle spot and 1 year at the right tackle. So he's played both, which is great. And again, and the SEC is huge. He plays against the best pass rushers. And probably the best game film that I watched on him was against Kentucky. And he got to go against Josh Allen only about seven times the whole game. They moved Josh Allen around. You know, he went to the Jags, number six overall. And was it six or seven? It might have been seven. So, but anyway, top 10. And, you know, he only went against Josh Allen seven times, but he held his own. He got beat one time fairly bad, but there were several plays that you watch and you're like, okay, this kid can play against elite talent. He has shown that by being a three-year starter in the SEC. So started 40 consecutive games, which is absolutely key. You've got to have health up front and durability on that offensive line. And especially with a guy that can play both sides. So if an injury did happen, which would be awful to either of our tackles, we would be screwed. But this does kind of help that situation a little bit. So as far as the statistics go, he had 1,441 pass protection snaps in his career, and he allowed 8 sacks and 92 pressures during that time. So not ideal. He was beat quite often, and I'll explain why he got beat so often. But if we just step back, and again, this is the number 183rd player off the board. So you're not talking about starter quality. Could he become something like that? Possibly. Is this the replacement for Joe Staley when he retires in a year or 2 years? No, it's not. This is not. He is going to be a swing backup tackle and a life preserver at that position. This is not somebody that you're like, oh, we have our tackle of the future. That's not who he is. He ranked 35th in his class versus outside pressure and 95th in his class versus bull rush pressure. So I've seen some mentions out there on Twitter saying, can Skule move to guard for this year? Absolutely not. With the way he is built and the way he plays, that's not a good combination. His weakness is against power, so you don't want to put him in a guard position where he's going to be required to just handle power pressure. So that's a no. Now, he did have 9 pancake blocks in 2018, but he's not a mean guy. It's not really what he is. He played in the East-West Shrine game, did okay there, nothing really special again. You know, you go through the film and you're just like, oh, okay, oh yeah, that's not great, but it's not bad either. And he's just kind of like, this is who he is. When you watch his film, it's just like, meh. He gets the job done most of the time. The problem with his film is he plays way too top-heavy. He's a big, tall kid. And he does not have the hip bend that you want. You know, as a former old line coach, you'd always say, sit in your bucket, get in your bucket, basically, when we had kids that couldn't bend, you would literally get a bucket out and you'd get them to come out of their stance and bend to where their ass is touching the edge of a bucket. And he is just way too high. His hip bend is not there, and he plays almost standing up a lot of times. And so, like, there's some game films where you can get a really good, I guess, kind of lower view of the field. The camera's not as high, basically bird's eye view. It's more from the sideline, and you can tell he has the highest hat on every play. And low man wins. Now, the thing that he has going for him is he has a lot of upper body strength. And so he is able to control a lot of the smaller guys just fine. But whenever he's going against kind of a bigger, powerful defensive end, it's always problematic for him. So he can be great in the run game, not always there, but whenever he does make his contact, he drives. He's a moving tackle blocker. And what I mean by that is he's going to make contact and he is going to move them every single time. He puts them where he wants them. So he always keeps his feet moving whenever he engages the defender, which is his best trait and what he does better than anything else. And again, it's just constant drive in the run game. I kept typing this as I'm watching this film. Like, great drive, good drive, gets movement, like over and over again. And this is what John Lynch said. He said, you know, he wins with good leverage and just gets the job done. I have no clue what he was talking about with good leverage. I don't see that anywhere on his film. But I defer to John Lynch on that. He does get the job done. He's an academic honor roll kid 3 years in a row. Vanderbilt's not an easy school to get into, obviously. And interesting fact that I found out, his dad is an FBI agent and played offensive line for the Naval Academy. So you've got somebody that's going to be going to have all his ducks in a row for sure. Could you imagine a dad being an FBI agent and playing offensive line for the Naval Academy? It just says a lot about who this kid is. And he studied economics. So we got a poli-sci guy and we got an economics guy. So now let's move on to Tim Harris, the third prospect and the last prospect we're going to talk about in our NFL draft coverage. We, again, another six-round pick. We love that sixth round. We got him towards the end, the 26th pick in the sixth round, number 198 overall. Tim Harris is unique. And once you get to the end of the sixth round and seventh round, the probability of making the roster is down pretty far. But he's an interesting kid because he didn't even start for his own team. You know, the first four games of the season, he didn't even start, but then he came on pretty well late. And one of the better secondaries in all of college football, you know, my pre-draft crush, you had Juan Thornhill as the safety, and it was pretty cool seeing them on the same side of the field. So I had seen a lot of his film before he was drafted. I just didn't grade this player out. It's what it is, you know. And when they asked, man, why'd you guys take this guy? And they were very honest. He said, this is a size speed guy that fits what we look for when in a cornerback. So he's 6'1", just under 6'2", 197 pounds out of Virginia. And there's good and bad here. So the good things, he was not invited to the combine. He's elite whenever it comes to measurements. You know, 4.4440 at his pro day, 39-inch vertical, very long. He had a 139-inch broad jump. And to put that into perspective, it's the second longest broad jump ever for a corner. Not this year, ever in the history of recorded broad jumps. It's second behind only Byron Jones out of Connecticut. So, and you could say, well, that's at your pro day. Well, there's certain things that change. 40 times at a pro day, you have to put an asterisk next to. Vertical and broad jump, you do not need to. Bench press, you do not need to. So this just shows you how explosive. I mean, you are talking 99th percentile as far as broad jump goes. And the broad jump's huge for corner and wide receivers because it measures your explosiveness and your hip power. And this kid's got it all. So length, height, speed, explosiveness, he checks all those boxes off. Now, the problem is it doesn't match on film all the time. So this is one of those project players that you're saying, man, if he can figure it out, he's definitely a guy that has these very rare traits that he belongs to the NFL. The problem is health and technique. So he is a six-year corner. And what I mean by that is he had two season-ending injuries. Oh, man, stop me if you've heard this before with the 49ers draft. So in 2016, he played the first two games, and then he had a horrible shoulder injury and missed the entire year. Then he comes back in 2017, and in the season opener, he breaks, fractures his wrist. He's out the whole year again. So back-to-back years, you know, with season-ending injuries was rough. Now, he was a guy that came in and played as a freshman, but because he's gone through this six-year track with an additional medical redshirt, he's much older already, and the injury history is huge. Now, the if we're going to be try to look on the bright side of life, none of these are lower body issues. Shoulder for a corner, they don't really hit a whole bunch. He is physical, though. Like, he's not scared to get in there and hit, and then a wrist. So, again, it's not ACL. It's not Achilles. It's not any of those things. It's not soft tissue, all that stuff. It's a shoulder, and it's a wrist. So you take for that what you want. So he only started the final eight games. He did play all 13, but he only started the last eight. On 95 targets, he did not get a lot of targets his way. He allowed 52 receptions and came out with a 54% catch rate. So you want that to be in the 50s, so those are good numbers. Now, the problem I have is that he had an 82% passer rating against. So the quarterbacks, when they targeted him, 82%, that is not okay. Only four career interceptions, 17 pass deflections, one fumble recovery. He's never forced a fumble. And probably the best thing that you can find about him, statistically speaking, because he does not have ball skills, is on 109 tackles, he only had 11 missed tackles, which for corners, that's pretty good. And you see that on film pretty well. He is a guy that whenever he wraps up, he is very textbook. He does not miss a lot of tackles. So my notes for his game film, size, speed, and explosiveness. You see it every single play. Lack of ball skills and health is why he went in the sixth round. He does play with a lot of energy. He comes out fired up every game. It's pretty fun watching the first quarter with him. Not near as fun watching the fourth quarter with him. It just seems like he comes out with so much energy to start the game. It just dissipates as the game goes on, which is a bummer. You want somebody that can maintain that level. That's something that he's going to have to work on. Very slow to react out of wide receivers in their breaks. And this is one of those things, there's a spectrum. Because you want to teach corners to stay calm and be patient, but he takes that to a new level. He's way too patient. And also, he likes to peek into the backfield, but this is something that both corners at Virginia did. So I'm not so sure if this was what they were coached to do. It seems like it is what they were coached to do, but this is going to be a bad habit, something that you don't want to necessarily do, especially in a cover three. So there's going to be a little bit of a scheme transition there, where instead of opening up your hips to the quarterback, you're going to open up your hips to the boundary and try to force him out. So he's going to have some transition there, but it's what it is. You know, John Lynch said, he came out and said, you can't have enough good corners. He's a profile fit. 6'2", 200, can run a 4.4. He's exclusively a corner, which I'm very glad to hear him say. We don't want to try him at safety or nickel or any of those things. And he did say, you know, he's got a lot of injury history, but in the sixth round, you've got to trust your medical staff. We do have a new medical staff this year. It's problematic how many players the 49ers have relied upon that have such an injury history. However, this is the NFL. And if you only stuck with players that were never injured, you wouldn't have a full roster. So, but I do think that we are one of the teams that lean and we kind of give the injury pass too often. But here in the sixth round, I don't mind that. I really, really don't. Now, they did ask John Lynch again, why no secondary drafted until late? And John Lynch said, you know, at the corner position, we took a flyer on Jason Verrett. And he's got an injury history as well. But that's what they're trying to do. And Kyle Shanahan added to that, you know, our secondary is not the easiest thing to beat guys out we already have. So if we look at our depth chart, you know, if everybody stays healthy, this is what our secondary will look like, I believe. Our starting outside corners are going to be Richard Sherman and Jason Verrett. If Jason Verrett is healthy, he might be one of the best corners we have. Might be the best corner we have. He is beyond elite. He doesn't fit the size speed. He's a shorter guy, 5'10". But he is absolutely incredible, and he played in the exact same system you know, for the Chargers as he's going to be doing for us. So he understands the system and he's excelled in that. He's just been injured so much. I think our slot guy is going to be Kwon Williams. And then after that, you're looking at guys like Aquilo and Tavarius Moore. What are you going to do with those two guys? I think they're going to be the outside corners, the backups that's going to get the first shot. If somebody goes down, they'll work in some dime situations for sure. But that's what we got. You know, DJ Reed, is he going to be a safety or is he going to be a nickel guy? I think he can do both. And then, you know, we've got guys like Greg Maben, who hopefully he doesn't take a snap all year. Special team guy and all that. So what's Tim Harris going to have to do to make this roster? He's going to have to impress, because if you're going to keep him, you're going to bounce a veteran like Greg Maben, which I am 100% okay with. It's just, does he have the tools? So he's going to have a learning curve. It's going to be an uphill battle. I'd probably give him a 40% chance of making this roster. Even as I say that, you know, I want to drop that number down just a little bit if I was creating betting odds. But that's what it is. So thank you guys for this. I am currently working on an offensive line breakdown for all 32 teams in the NFL for Eat Sleep Fantasy. And I don't say this enough, but you know, I put content out there on a lot of different sites. I'm writing for Dynasty League Football if you are interested in Dynasty stuff with drafts and all that coming up. And I also write for Eat Sleep Fantasy for all redraft and just other fantasy random football nuggets. So if you want to see any of my stuff, please head over to those two sites. It's there for you. And also, if you haven't already, please head over to my Twitter account and register for that free Joe Montana signed jersey. Thanks, guys, and we will be back with you shortly.